graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Vampire Hunter D, Volume 3, Demon Death Chase, by Hideyuki Kikuchi and Yoshitaka Amano. Translated by Kevin Leahy. Narrated by Scott McCormick. And performed by a full cast.
Chapter 1, Village of the Dead. The tiny village obstinately refused the blessings the sunlight poured down so generously upon it. Though a frontier village like this might see its share of years, as a rule, the size of the community didn't fluctuate greatly. The village's 80 or so homes wavered in the warming light. Every last bit of the lingering snow had been consumed by the black soil. Spring was near. And yet the village was dead. Doors of reinforced plastic and treated lumber hung open, swinging with the feeble breeze. In the communal cookery, which should have been roiling with the lively voices of wives and children as evening approached, now dust danced alone. Something was missing. People. The majority of the homes remained in perfect order, with no signs of any struggle by the occupants. But in one or two, there were overturned chairs in the living room. In one house, the bed covers were disheveled, as if someone just settling down to sleep had gotten out of bed to attend to some trifling matter. Had gotten out, and had never come back. Small black stains could be found on the floors of that house. A number of spots no bigger than the tip of your little finger. They might be mistaken for a bit of fur off a pet dog or cat. The spots wouldn't catch anyone's eye. Even if they would, there were no people around with eyes to be caught. Evening grew near. The white sunlight took on a dim bluish tint. The wind blowing down the deserted streets grew more insistent, and an eerie atmosphere pervaded the village at dusk, like ebon silhouettes were coalescing in the shadows, and training their bloodshot gaze on any travelers that might pass through the wide-open gates. More time passed. Just when the dim shadows were beginning to linger in the streets, the sound of iron-shod hooves pounding the earth and the crush of tires and well-worn ruts came drifting in through the entrance to the village. A bus and three people on horseback came to a halt in front of the watchtowers just inside the gates. The atomic-powered bus was the sort used for communications across the frontier, but its body had been modified, so that now iron bars were set into the windows and a trenchant plow was affixed to the front of the vehicle. Not exactly the sort of vehicle upstanding folks had much call for. Every inch of the vehicle was jet black, a perfect complement to the foreboding air of the trio looming before it.
What the hell's going on here?
The man on the right wore a black shirt and black leather pants. Conspicuous for his fierce expression and frightfully long torso, this man would stand out anywhere.
Don't look like our client's here to meet us.
Though the man on the far left's face wore a wry smile, his thread-thin eyes brimmed with a terrible light as they scoured his surroundings. A hexagonal staff strapped to his well-defined back made his shadow appear impaled. As if on cue, the two turned their heads toward the even more muscular giant standing between them. From neck to wrist, his body was covered by a protector of thin metal on leather, but the mountain of muscles beneath it was still sharply defined. His face was like a chunk of granite that had sprouted whiskers.
Looks like they've had it. The whole damn village gone in one night. Looks like we lost the goose that laid the golden egg. Just to be sure, let's check out a few houses. Carefully.
I ain't too crazy about that idea. How about we send Grove? For him, it'd...
The giant had shot a glance at him. It was like being scrutinized by a stone.
I was just kidding, bro.
It wasn't merely the difference in their builds that made the man in black grow pale. It appeared that the man truly feared the giant, quickly dismounting, the man with the hexagonal staff did likewise. They then entered the village with a gliding gait. The face of a girl with blonde hair peered out at the giant from the bus's driver's seat.
Borgoth? What's up?
At 22 or 3 years old, her visage was as lovely as a blossom, and there was something about how overly alluring it was that called to mind a carnivorous insect. Beautiful, but deadly.
Odds are the village has been wasted. Be ready to move on a moment's notice. How's Grove?
He's okay. For the moment. Not likely to have another seizure for a while.
It was unclear whether or not the giant heard the girl's response, as he didn't so much as nod, but kept gazing at the silent, lonely rows of houses. He flicked his eyes up toward the sky, and the round moon was already showing its pearly white figure.
Wish we had a little more cloud cover.
Just as he'd muttered those words, two figures came speeding down the street as if riding the very wind.
It's just like we thought. Not a single freaking person.
The man with the hexagonal staff turned to the sky.
Sun'll be setting soon. Safest bet would be to blow this place as soon as possible, big guy.
Apparently the giant easily pierced the hazy darkness to glimpse the tiny black spot on the tip of that finger.
Make for the graveyard.
In a flash, a tense hue shot through the faces of the other men. But soon enough, they too grinned, climbed effortlessly back on their horses, and boldly started their mounts down village streets that had fallen into the stillness of death. So, what had transpired in the village? Having the entire populace of a place disappear in one fell swoop wasn't such a bizarre occurrence on the frontier. For example, the carnivorous balloon-like creature known as flying jellyfish seemed to produce an extremely large specimen at a rate of one every 20 years or so. The beast was often a mile and a quarter in diameter, and it could cover an entire village, selectively dissolving every living creature before sucking them all up into its maw. And then there was the basilisk, a magical creature said to inhabit only deep mountain ravines and haunted valleys. It had merely to wait at the entrance to a village and stare fixedly at a given spot within. Its single gigantic eye would glow a reddish tint before finally releasing a crimson beam, and villagers would come, first one, then another, right into its fearsome waiting jaws. But the sole weakness of the basilisk was that occasionally one of the hypnotized humans would bid farewell to their family, and when they did so, it was always in exactly the same words. Hearing those words, the remaining folk would go out and hunt the basilisk en masse. However, the most likely cause of every last person vanishing from an entire village was both the most familiar of threats and the most terrifying. When news of such an eerie happening was passing along by even a single traveler lucky enough to have slipped through such a community unharmed, people could practically hear the footfalls of their dark lords, supposedly long since extinct, lingering in that area. The masters of the darkness, the vampires. Having arrived at the graveyard on the edge of the town, the trio of riders and lone vehicle came to an abrupt halt. In a spot not 500 yards from the forest, moss-encrusted gravestones formed serpentine rows, and there was an open space where little by little the blue-dark blackness rose from the ground. The fearsome trio strode forward, keeping their eyes on everything, coming to a halt in the depths of a forest that threatened to overrun the tombstones. From that spot alone, an area where something had turned over a large expanse of ground to reveal the red clay and left it looking like a subterranean demon had run amok, there blew a weird miasma. It was a presence so ghastly it froze the leading pair atop their horses and made the giant swallow so hard his Adam's apple thumped in his throat. What lay concealed by this ravaged earth? Moving only their eyes, the men scanned the area in search of the source of the miasma. The men didn't move, Partly it was the ghastly miasma, twisting tight around their bones, that prevented them from moving. But more than anything, they were still because that voice, those moans seemed to issue from within the bus. When the giant had asked, hadn't the girl said he wouldn't have a seizure? It must have been the bizarre atmosphere billowing through this place that made a liar of her. Or perhaps his cries were because, no matter what illness afflicted them, there was something humans found horribly unsettling and inescapable about their mortal condition. A few seconds later, a figure appeared from behind one of the massive tree trunks, as if to offer some answer to the riddle. A veritable ghost, it stepped its way across the red clay in a precarious gait, coming to a standstill at a spot about 10 feet ahead of them. The figure that loomed before the glimmering silver moon was that of an older man of 50 or so, with a dignified countenance and silver hair that seemed to give off a whitish glow of its own. Anyone would have taken him for a village elder. Actually, however, this old man was doing two things that, when witnessed by those who knew about such matters, were as disturbing as anything could possibly be. He was using his left hand to pin his jacket, with his upturned collar to his chest, while his open right hand covered his mouth, as if to conceal his teeth.
Thank you for coming. Thank you for coming, but you're too late. Every last soul in the village is done for, myself included, but...
There was nothing before the old man's pupils, stagnant and muddy like those of a dead fish. Only a long line of trees continuing on into the abruptly growing darkness.
Hurry. Go after him. He made off with my daughter. Please, hurry after them and get her back. Or if she's already one of them, please make her end a quick one.
Appealing. Entreating. The old man went on, not so much as glancing at the men before him. He faced an empty spot between the trees, with the darkness so dear to demons steadily creeping in around them. It was an unsettling sight.
He'd been after my daughter for a while. Time after time he tried to take her, and each and every time I fought him off. But last night, he finally showed his fangs. Once he got one of us, the rest fell like dominoes. I'm begging you, save my daughter from that accursed fate. Last night he took off to the north. With your speed, there still might be time. If you manage to save my daughter, go to the town of Galusha. My younger sister's there. If you explain the situation, she'll give you the $10 million I promised. I beg of you.
At this point in the old man's speech, the heap of dirt behind him underwent a change. A small mound bulged up suddenly, and then a pale hand burst through the dirt, resembling the dead man's hand flowers that bloomed only by night. This was in fact a real hand. The figures pushing through the dirt and rising one after another were the villagers, transformed into vampires in the span of a single night, appearing just as they had in life, only now with complexions as sickly pale as paraffin. When the moonlight struck them, they glowed with an eerie, pale blue light. There were burly men, there were dainty women, there were girls in dresses, there were boys in short pants, nearly 500 strong, their bloodshot eyes gleaming and their mouths set.
Oh, it's too late now. Kill us somehow. Get out of here. Once it's really night, I'll be...
The old man's left hand dropped. The pair of wounds that remained on the nape of his neck also showed on those of the other villagers. It's hard to say which happened first, the old man lowering his right hand or the men's jaws dropping from between his lips. Thrown perilously wide, a pair of fangs jutted from the upper gums.
Yeah, now it's getting interesting.
The man in black reached for the crescent blades at his waist. Perhaps the eldritch spell that held them had been broken, for the hands of the man with the hexagonal staff were gliding to his weapon. The old man zipped effortlessly forward, along with the mob at his back.
Giddy up!
As if this was just what he'd been waiting for, the man in black spurred his horse into action. The man with the hexagonal staff followed after him, and the giant waited behind. A number of the villagers had their heads staved in under the hooves. falling backward only to have their sternums and abdomens trampled as well.
What are you waiting for, freaks? Come and get it!
As the man in black shouted, the heads of nearly half of the fang-bearing villagers closing in on him from the sides went sailing into the air, sliced cleanly like so many watermelons. An instant later, silver light limbed another corona, and the heads flew from the next rank. Novice vampires dropped to the ground, leaking gray matter or spouting bloody geysers as if they were fountainheads. What had severed the heads of the vampire victims so cleanly was one of the blades that had hung at the man's waist. The blades were about a foot in diameter and shaped like a half moon. Honed to a razor-fine arc, the weapon was known among warriors on the frontier as the crescent blade. A wire or cord was usually affixed to one end, and the wielder could set up a sort of safety zone around himself, keeping his enemies at bay by spinning the blade as widely or as tightly as he wished. Due to the intense training necessary to handle it, there were few who could use one effectively. It didn't seem possible that anything he set his sights on would be spared. Another sound came from his companion's favorite weapon, the hexagonal staff that was always on his back. Both ends had sharp protrusions, veritable stakes. But normally this weapon would be spun and used to bludgeon opponents. Its owner was using the hexagonal staff in this manner. However, the way that he swung the staff was unique. Spinning it around his waist like a water wheel set on its side, he smashed in the head of a foe to his right, spun it clear around his back, and took out an opponent to his left. In a snap, four shadowy figures hung in the air to the left and the right of the man with the hexagonal staff, and before and behind him as well. His movements were sheer magic. Still, the villagers numbered 500. Even with the skills this pair had, they couldn't keep the vampires from attacking the bus. In fact, the other vampires ignored the two of them and pounded across the ground in a dash for the vehicle. The wind roared, and the villagers fell like beads from a string, only to be skewered together again by arrows from the giant's bow. The bow itself wasn't the kind of finished good you'd find for sale in city shops. It was a savage thing, just a handy low-hanging branch that had been snapped off and strung with the gut of some beast. Even the contents of the quiver strapped to both of the giant's flanks and his back were no more than simple iron rods filed to a point. But in the hands of this giant, they became missiles of unrivaled accuracy. The giant didn't use them one at a time. Drawing back five at once, he released his arrows simultaneously. Not a single arrow missed the mark. But the question was, how could the giant choose a target and move his bow in less time than it took to blink? This remained a mystery, even as the villagers left corpse upon corpse heaped before the bus. The shriek came from inside the bus.
That ain't good. Fall back. Fall back.
Before the giant had shouted the words, the men were whipping around toward the bus behind them. The villagers started to run. When the rapidly dwindling distance shrunk to a mere 15 feet, the ground-pounding feet of the fiends came to an unexpected halt. A lone youth suddenly stood between them and the bus, blocking them. But it was not that alone that stopped the rush of these bloodthirsty creatures. For starters, there was the question of where this youth had appeared from. With the gentle wave in the forelock touching his brow, the youth's face was strong and had a healthy tone. And from the center of it, his innocent eyes gazed at the hillspawn without a hint of fear. The villagers who'd hesitated due to the way the youth unexpectedly appeared must have deemed him the most desirable of prey. An instant later, they were pressing forward toward him as a single tide. And then something happened. Into the darkness were born a number of streaks of light. Each individual flash lanced through the hearts of countless villagers. 500 vampires hit in an instant. Flames spouting from their chests, the villagers fell. Writhing, then stiffening, The peaceful faces that came with death were surely the ones they'd had until dusk of the day before, returning to them now as serene as masks. From the cover of the bus, the man with the hexagonal staff slowly showed his face.
Wow, pretty damn intense. Whew.
He looked up at one of the windows on the bus.
Is good old Grove doing all right?
He didn't even glance at the young man who'd done all this. The man had already vanished, every bit as mysteriously as he'd appeared.
Couldn't be helped, and what's done is done.
The man in black came around from the other side.
We've got bigger fish to fry. The geezer said the noble that grabbed his daughter took off to the north, right? If we go now, we could definitely catch up to him, bro. We could track him, run him down. 10 million if we bring her back safe. Sure, he's probably already had his way with her, but what the hell? We'd be dealing with a woman on the other end. We could threaten her, tell her we'd chop the girl's head off along with the vampires and turned her back into a human. She'd keep her trap shut and pay up.
That'd all be well and good if he'd been talking to us.
What do you mean?
The man in black looked at the giant's face, then followed the giant's line of sight toward the thicket ahead of them and off to the right. Earlier, that was the same spot the old man had addressed when he spoke.
Come on out!
As the giant said this, a crescent blade in the man's right hand gleamed in the moonlight, and the hexagonal staff ripped through the wind. They too had known that this unearthly miasma hadn't belonged to the old man. The one responsible for it was in the woods. Their hands went to their weapons. The aura that came from the thicket gave them the same chill that radiated from the nobility.
If you don't come out, we're coming in. But from the way that old man was talking to you, I'm guessing we've got to be in the same line of work. Hell, it seems like you're even more dependable than we are. If that's the case, we don't want to do nothing stupid. What do you say we talk this 10 million deal out all friendly-like?
There was no answer, nor any movement.
Bro, this way's a lot quicker.
The crescent blade flew from the hand of the man in black. While it wasn't clear what it was constructed of, it wove through the trees, speeding to the spot at which the giant glowered. It was an assault devoid of ceremony, but steeped in murderous intent. A silver flash of light coursed back out between the trees. The two men jumped out of the way. What the giant now grasped in his right hand was the same crescent blade the man in black had just unleashed. A red band was slowly running down its finely honed surface. Fresh blood poured from the giant's hand. The emotional hue welling up on that rock-like face was one of fury, and also one of fright.
Not bad.
The man with the hexagonal staff gave a kick to his horse's flanks. The horse didn't move. Once again he kicked. The hides of the flanks broke, and blood trickled out. And yet still, the horse didn't move. The doors of the bus opened. A girl stuck her head out.
What's going on, guys?
Acutely sensitive to the presence there, her beautiful face turned automatically to the depths of the woods, imitating her older brother's. In the depths of the darkness, the presence stirred. The clop of hooves drew steadily closer. Suddenly, the youth was before them, bathed in moonlight. It was as if the darkness itself had crystallized and taken human form. Mysterious as the sparkle of the blue pendant shining from the breast of his black coat was, it ranked a distant second to the gorgeous visage that showed below the traveler's hat. Astride his horse with the reins in his fist, the beautiful youth seemed as calm as any traveler passing through by happenstance. But one look at him, and it was clear he was far from being a mere traveler.
What the hell are you supposed to be?
The shadowy figure didn't answer. He moved forward, seemingly intent on casually breezing past them.
Hold up.
The man with the hexagonal staff made an attempt to stop him.
Look, buddy, you might be one of the hunters that geezer called, but so are we. Sure, we might have been in the wrong, flying off and taking a poke at you like that. There's no harm in us all introducing ourselves. We're the Marcus clan. I'm Nolt, second oldest of the boys.
The shadowy figure halted his advance.
This here's Kyle, youngest brother.
Eyes gleaming with animosity, The man in black made no attempt at a greeting.
The great big fella is our older brother Borgov.
Just as his brother finished introducing him, a sharp sound came from around the giant's thigh. The crescent blade, now in two pieces, fell to the ground with a shower of glittering silver flecks. The unusual break in it was not from folding. It was from squeezing. The giant wiped his bloody palm on his horse's ear. Blood stuck in the creature's coat, forcing the hair to fall in a mat.
We've got another brother, but he's sick and doesn't get out of our ride. And finally, there's Layla, our baby sister.
Nice to meet you, Mr. Tight Lips.
Layla's bright feline eyes burned with flames of hostility. However, when the face of the traveler made a rapid turn in her direction, those flames suddenly wavered.
The Marcus Clan. I've heard of you.
The Marcus Clan was the most skillful vampire hunting group on the frontier. Consisting of five members, the family, from oldest to youngest, was Borgoff, Nolt, Grovek, Kyle, and Layla. The number of nobles they'd taken care of reached triple digits, and word of how miraculously none of the clan had been lost in the process circulated far and wide among the people on the frontier. At the same time, so did tales of the clan's cruelty and callousness. Nowhere did it say only one vampire hunter or group of hunters could be hired for a given case. Considering the vengeance the nobility would wreak in the event of failure, it was perfectly normal for the person concerned to employ a number of individuals, or even several groups. The Marcus clan always lasted until the end, they alone. No individual group that had worked with them, or against them for that matter, had ever survived. Due to the fact that none of the other hunters' corpses had ever been recovered, there was no choice but to believe the Marcus's claim that the hunters were slain by the nobility. But rumors spread like wildfire, and now an ominous storm of suspicion swirled over the clan members' heads. In all likelihood, this was probably the first time the clan had ever heard a man say their name so calmly.
Look, jerk!
Unexpectedly, the giant, Borgoff, made a strange face.
Pal? I've heard about someone with your looks and a blue pendant. 10 years back, this one village elder told us there was only one hunter in all the frontier that was a match for us, let alone he was probably tougher than all of us put together or some such thing. But you couldn't be.
Giving no answer, the young man turned away, as if completely unconcerned by the bunch of fearsome villains in front of him.
Hey, wait up! We're going after the noble that grabbed the geezer's daughter. If you're not with us, that makes you an enemy too. Is that the way you want it?
There was no response, and the horse and rider's silhouette was swallowed by the darkness.
We're not gonna let him go, are we?
A dampier. Is that what he is, then?
This was the first time the younger siblings had heard the man speak in such a tone, or say a certain mysterious name.
I finally met a man I actually fear. D.
The spot was 30 miles north of the village of Vishnu, where wholesale slaughter followed tragedy in just 2 short days. A lone black carriage rushed along the narrow road through the forest. The 6 horses that pulled it were ebon too, and the driver in the coachman's perch was garbed in black. The whole vehicle seemed born of the darkness. Showering the horses with merciless lashes, the driver occasionally looked to the heavens. The sky was so full of stars it seemed to be falling. Their light seemed to flicker on the face gazing up at them. The graceful visage of the driver clouded suddenly.
The stars moved. Those giving chase. To me. 6 of them.
There in the darkness, his eyes began to give off a blazing light.
And no mere pursuers at that. Each possessed of extraordinary skill. One of them in particular.
As if unable to contain his agitation, he stood upright in the coachman's perch, shaking the jet-black vehicle beneath his feet.
I won't let them have her. I won't let anyone take her away.
Light coursed from the eyes he opened wide. Bloodlight. When turbulence had raced into that graceful face, one of the right wheels slipped off the axle with a crash. The carriage lurched wildly to the right, kicking up a thick cloud of dust as the carriage rolled over. What was truly unbelievable was the acrobatics of the driver. Releasing the reins of his own accord, sailing through the air, and skillfully twisting his body, he regained his balance, landing like a length of black cloth a few yards from the carriage. Anxiety and despair filled his face as he dashed to the vehicle. Throwing the door open like a man possessed, he peered inside. His anxiety was replaced by relief. He approached the special metal alloy wagon wheel.
So, misfortune has decided to put in an unfashionably early appearance.
He lifted the wheel and walked back to the carriage. He looked to the sky once again.
Soon the day will be breaking. Seems I shall be walking to the shelter and repairing this when it's night again. That's more than enough time for those dogs to catch up to us.
Around the time the mountain ridges were rising faintly from the darkness, like the edges of so many jigsaw pieces, the pair halted their horses. They were atop a fair-sized hill.
Old Borgoff's got us doing some crazy shit, riding hard in the middle of a night like this. I tell you, he's all worked up over nothing.
In the pale, panting darkness of daybreak, this man alone seemed blackly clad in the remnants of night. In a black shirt and pants, it was Kyle, the youngest of the Marcus boys. The ebon flecks that remained like stains, not just on his right hand, but on his chest and shoulder as well, were splashes of blood from all the nocturnal beasts they had cut down during their ride.
Thought he told you to stow that talk. That punk? He's no garden variety hunter. You must have heard about him too.
That was Nolt, the second oldest.
Ha! You mean how he's a dampier? A lousy half-breed. Part nobility and part human. Oh, sure. Everyone says they make the best vampire hunters, don't they? But let's not forget something. We slaughter real full-blooded nobles.
Hey, you got a point there.
If he's a half-breed, he's more like us than the nobility. Nothing to be afraid of.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.